for the other rentals. And actually, I'm sorry, what was your name? In the back there.
Oh, John.
John, John did like all five of them. Nobody's ever done that right off the bat.
There you go.
Thanks, John. So work with me on the memos. Let me look at them. I've looked at some at least, you know, three or four times already, and then we can start digging into some content. And then, you know, I'll show you how to apply the economics and put the data in there and really get the memos to where they can, where you can actually use them. Okay. So quickly, where's the Dow? Okay. Just don't sit there. Where's the Dow right now? Where's the settlement? Jump on the computer. What?
It went down.
It's down by how much?
0.08%, 17.6.
Okay, why?
Why?
Yeah. I mean, don't you want to know why? I mean, it doesn't really make sense if prices go up and down. Isn't the question why? So anybody have any interpretation of why the Dow is down? No? Usually when you look up the Dow on Yahoo Finance, if you go to Yahoo Finance, or even if you just go to Yahoo, you can even go to Bloomberg, but let's just use Yahoo, you know, the fake news website. Why don't we just go straight there and take a look at the what's streaming. And there might be some political news, there may be instability in the Middle East, there could be policy announcements. I know Paul Ryan is talking up, you know, tax reform. He's been ready to talk with Steve Bannon and Donald Trump about tax reform. That's probably a big issue. You know, what's going on out of Europe? London just closed, and Tokyo's getting ready to ramp up. Those are all factors that have a factor on the Dow, so think about it. Where's oil trading right now, per barrel? Again, remember, simulated trading environment, not a classroom, but, you know, we're actually in a room trading these commodities. I'm paying you $500,000 a year with bonuses of potentially a million. You can make some serious money if you know what you're doing. So where's oil trading right now?
53.30.
53, wasn't it trading about 55?
Yeah, it's gone down all
the time. Okay, so there's gotta be some kind of news on rig counts or the Saudis not being able to push through the cuts in production. Maybe the US, you know, is exporting more than ever before. Our oil reserves are at their all-time high. You got to start being able to answer the why questions. Okay, where's gold per ounce?
Down 60 basis points.
Down 60 basis points right now, so it's falling. So the Dow is down, gold is down. What's the 10-year treasury doing right now? What's the 10-year treasury? Because if the Dow is down, and if gold is down, then I bet the 10-year treasury yield has gone down and the prices of bonds have gone up. So where's the yield on the 10-year treasury right now?
2.35,
and it's dropped what, like?
0.93.
Yeah, like almost 20 basis points over the last maybe week or two. Maybe not that much. But people are now starting to think that the Fed's not going to raise interest rates, which is having a major impact on the 10-year treasury. And we're in somewhat of some type of political calm right now, so people are starting to move back into U.S. treasuries. And obviously, the U.S. treasury, what's the yield on the U.S. 10-year?
2.35.
And I think the German 10-year is like 0.5. So the spread between the U.S. interest rates and German interest rates is like 200 basis points or 2 percentage points. Is that a lot? Is that a lot?
Yeah,
that's a lot. So the question then becomes, if that's a lot, then there's probably massive capital flows continuing to flow into the United States. So give me the exchange rate on the pound and the dollar. I mean, how many dollars does it take for me to buy a pound? How many dollars does it take for me to buy a euro?
1.24.
What is it?
1.24 pounds.
1.24? Okay, so actually it sounds like the pound's appreciated. Because I guess there's talk right now that they may not be able to exit Brexit, and that the cost of exiting Brexit is going to be severely more than the British citizens actually think it's going to be. And then you have, you know, David Cameron and all these people coming out saying, whoa, 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 you probably don't want to leave Brexit. So that could cause the pound to appreciate. Where's the euro right now?
1.06.
1.06? And where was it? I mean, if you're a currency trader, you're watching all this stuff.
The euro's depreciated about 0.2%.
Against the dollar? So the dollar's appreciated, the euro's depreciated. Okay, so there's something going on there, and usually it surrounds Germany. So when you start looking up these statistics, start trying to figure out the economics and the politics behind it, and put yourself into a trader's mindset and a portfolio manager's mindset. Okay. We already went over the memo, awesome. We're gonna do some quick, since I have, 50, who's my timekeeper? How much time do I have? 55? Okay. Let me see if I can go through this in 5 minutes, and then we can go through the spend 50 minutes on the lecture for the chapter. Okay. So very quick, I would start bringing the in-class exam, okay, to class, so we can go over it really quickly. And then what I want to do is I want to burn through this stuff pretty quickly. Do you have a copy of the?
Yeah.
And then what I would do is I'd write a bunch of notes really quickly as I go through this. And I want to get to financial product innovation, modern portfolio theory, derivative trades, technical analysis, and intrinsic valuations. So this stuff's pretty straightforward. When building a forecast model, what are the first steps? Question. Did you already go over this? Okay. What are the first steps questions that need to be taken? When you're building a forecast model, the first question is when somebody comes to you and says, hey, I want you to build a forecast model for us. First question is, what do you want to forecast? You want to forecast sales, you want to forecast revenues, you want to forecast earnings per share, you want to forecast dividends, you want to forecast free cash flow. What is returns? What is it do you want to forecast? And then how do you determine the dependent and independent variable? Usually your sponsor, which is your boss, is going to tell you what they want to forecast. And that's going to determine the dependent variable. You might have to work with them to refine and create more precision on what it is exactly that you want to forecast. Then the second is, how do you determine the independent variables? The second thing that comes out of your mouth, the first that comes out of your mouth when they say, will you build a forecast model for me? First thing that comes out of your mouth is yes. The second is, what do you want to forecast? The third is, what are the variables that you think should be in the model based on your experience that would forecast what's in return on your stock? So you start talking to people inside the firm and outside the firm and start doing a survey to find out what variables they think drives tech sales, you know, for our company. Then you go over to the library and you look up in the peer-reviewed journal articles, you do a search, and you say, you type in forecasting high-tech semiconductor sales. And then all these articles will come out from industry experts and academics who have basically tried to answer that question. And look at the models and look at the variables that have come up over and over and over again as doing the best job to predict that dependent variable. How would you test variable and model significance? You would look at the adjusted R-square. You would look at the F statistic, when you're looking at model significance. You would look at the T statistic, when you're looking at individual variable statistical significance. And you would look at the beta coefficient, the T step between the dependent and independent. And you would look for the correlation between the independent and the dependent. Okay. If you were experiencing multicollinearity in your model, and if you had two variables that were highly correlated to the dependent, and correlated to themselves, how would you decide which one to keep and which one to throw out? You keep the one that came up the most in the peer-reviewed journal articles in literature as the best variable that came up over and over again in predicting semiconductor sales. Okay, not the statistical significance, but the theoretical significance based on external validation. Internal validity is talking to people inside the firm to confirm the model and the variables. external validity is going to the literature. I have to go get a drink of water. Hold on a second. I'm losing my voice. What is the size of the Federal Reserve's balance sheet? 4.5 trillion. How much money by banks are being held on reserve at the Federal Reserve? 4.5 trillion. 4.5 trillion for both. The balance sheet is 4.5 trillion, the reserves are 4.5 trillion. What was it prior to 07? 1 trillion. So it's almost five times what it was prior to 07. What has been the growth in the money supply since 2007? In 2008, 9, and 10, it was between 30 and 40%. In 11, 12, 13, it was 10%. In 14, 15, 16, it was between 5 and 8%. So the money supply growth rate's come down significantly. As the Fed hit gross domestic product targets, right now GDP is around 1.9. They're shooting for 3, so the answer is no. Employment, unemployment. The unemployment rate is about 4.8, 4.9. They're targeting 5%, so the answer is yes. Inflation targets. Inflation currently, recently has been around 1%, so the answer is no, and they were targeting 2%. But the inflation rate now is around 2%, so the answer is yes. So it was no, now it's yes. If we were to fall into a recession, would the Fed use negative interest rates? Yes. She's already said it. What would be the impact on the economy? Negative interest rates would drive down the cost of capital and try to increase consumption and investment through lower cost of capital. So try to stimulate the economy. What would happen to asset prices? They would be propped up. Because remember, the cash flow divided by the discount rate, well, if interest rates are falling, then asset prices are being propped up. Savers, the impact on savers would be detrimental. Because as interest rates go negative, deposit rates at banks would probably go negative too, or be zero. And then yields on treasury securities would be negative. So basically, you're buying an investment, you're paying the government to basically lend them money, okay? So it'd be awful for them. And then for businesses, they would probably benefit from low cost of capital, but if the extremely low or negative interest rates doesn't stimulate the economy, it's eventually gonna affect businesses negatively and affect their stock prices, okay? Yield curve dynamics, using the Fisher equation, what variables drive risk-free rates or nominal interest rates? Well, real rates and inflation expectations. Inflation expectations or real rates go up, then nominal interest rates go up. If real rates or inflation expectations go down, interest rates go down. Shifts of the yield curve up and down, flattens, inverts. Well, if inflation expectations in the short run are rising, then the curve's going to flatten and then will invert. So you have to play with that equation. Look at the notes from the last one. Show the equation and graphical representation of an upward sloping curve, flat curve, and inverted curve. What are the three yield curve theories? Expectations hypothesis, liquidity preference, preferred habitat, and market segmentation. Okay. What impact do movements and shifts in the yield curve have on asset prices? Well, when the yield curve shifts up, asset prices go down. When yield curves shift down, asset prices go up, very simply. How does the Federal Reserve influence interest rates? through open market operations, through the Federal Reserve of New York, through open market operations, the Federal Reserve will buy bonds, drive bond prices up and interest rates down. Or they will sell bonds, drive bond prices down and interest rates up. What policy tool do they use to move interest rates? Open market operations. What is the objective of buying and selling bonds? To drive interest rates up and down. To drive interest rates up, to cool the economy, to mitigate inflation, or to drive interest rates down, to stimulate the economy, to get it to grow. If the Fed buys and sells bonds, what is the impact on bond prices? Well, if they buy bond prices go up. If they sell bonds, bond prices go down. What is the impact on interest rates? Well, if they buy bond prices go up and interest rates go down. If they sell bond prices go down, interest rates go up. Okay, I'm testing you to see if you know the logic. Does the Fed control and influence directly short-term or long-term interest rates? They control directly short-term interest rates, also long-term interest rates. The market forces, the market determines long-term interest rates. What are your overall observations of the relationship or correlation between the yield curve and the S&P 500 since 1998? Did the yield curve lead or lag the peak in the stock market? It led the peak. If it did, by how many months? 12 months. Did the curve flatten or invert? It flattened and then inverted prior to the peak. On the short or long end of the curve, on the short end of the curve, can you use the yield curve to predict stock market peaks and recessions? Yes. The yield curve inverts 12 months before the stock market peaks, and we go into a recession 24 months after the yield curve inverts. And then the next one is the capital and commodity markets. We already went through that. You're going to have to tell me the level of the Dow, where oil prices are, where gold prices are, where oil yields are, and where currencies are trading. And then I'll go back and do the supply-demand analysis. On Thursday, I will go over product innovation and engineering, modern portfolio theory, derivative trades, technical analysis, and then a review of the evaluations. So I'll get through all that before we go to the exam. Okay, this will be the in-class component. Okay, any questions? So if you wrote all that down and you wrote really good notes, then you have a lot of it. Okay, I just want to test you to see if you were writing notes and stuff like that. And these are key takeaways. A lot of this stuff's not in the book. It's based on the lectures. Okay, and then the homework is due March 9th. Deliverable 1 is due Thursday the 16th. If you come see me between 8 and 9, Monday through Friday, Monday, Wednesday, Friday from 11:30 to 12:30, or Thursday from 1 to 2, you can check your answers on the exams and the homeworks. Okay, we'll do some problems in class, but if you get stuck on any of the problems, just move on, and then come see me and we'll walk through the problems where you're stuck. Do not waste your time. If you get stuck, move on. Okay, do not waste your time, because we can go back and remediate. And then these are my office hours, so come see me and I'll send around a sign-up sheet for time slots, and I'll start slotting you into these slots, but it'll be open for right now. And make sure you all sign that sheet that I gave you, the one with your name and major. If you want an internship or a job, tell me what kind of internship, what kind of job you want, with your phone number and your email. Okay? Because people are going to be hiring right now. Right? We're getting set up for the internships. People are getting graduating in May. So we're placing people for internships and jobs. If you haven't already gotten placed, you gotta be thinking right now, start landing that summer job or landing that summer internship. And they're very competitive positions, so you wanna be on top of it. You wanna get nailed down as soon as possible. Okay? Don't wait unless you're going to Europe for the summer, then forget everything that I just talked about. And if you don't need a job because your parents are rich, just forget what I just talked about. Be just fine. Okay, any questions or anything like that before I keep going? No, okay, so time value of money. Okay, we're gonna build on this throughout the whole semester. We're gonna be calculating future values, present values, discounted cash flows. This is basically the mechanics that we'll be built on throughout the whole semester. We'll look at simple interest, we'll look at compound interest, because again, when you invest in stock or you invest in real estate, there's going to be some compounding and cash flows. And the question is, are you going to get a really good return to be able to accumulate wealth, or are you going to make mistakes, lose money, or not get the return you expected, and not reach your goals and objectives at the end of the day? Compounding of a dollar invested grows over time, so it's wealth accumulation. This is basically intertemporal substitution. It's microeconomics. Basically, I'm going to invest today. I'm going to get some kind of return. It's going to compound, not only on the principal, but also on the interest. And then at X date in the future, since I sacrificed, you know, buying that BMW today, I can buy, you know, a bigger car in a nicer place in 5 years from now because I put my money to work. So I'm basically delaying consumption with the anticipation of a higher return or a higher accumulation of wealth at some point in time. So you're going to delay the consumption today to consume more tomorrow. And again, the trade-off, you're trading off consumption for investment. Time value of money, or what is also called discounted cash flows, is the present value of future cash flows. So you're going to be projecting out cash flows. You're going to be really good at projecting pro formas, projecting the cash flows. Then you're going to discount those cash flows to the present to get the present value, discount it back based on some return or cost of capital, and then you're going to compare the value to what you can buy or build it at, and if it's higher, you're going to accept it. You're going to do it. So you're going to have to come up with some expected return. If I invest in this stock, I want at least a 10% rate of return. That's my discount. Or if I'm going to invest in that company, we're going to buy that company, well, I need to know what my cost of capital is, i.e. my discount rate, so I can apply the discount rate to the future cash flows to discount them back to the present so that I can make the investment decision.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So the discount rate is going to be determined by the riskiness of the investment, maybe the effects of the capital markets. You know, my stock price goes down, my bond prices go down, my cost of capital is going up, my discount rate is going up, and the present value of those cash flows are going down. And I'll go over that with you like 100 times the logic burns into your brains. Overall, interest rates will have an effect on your discount rate, inflation rates. In most discount rates, there's an inflation risk premium embedded in it because you want to get real returns in the future. You're going to be adding risk premiums. If I'm buying a piece of real estate, I want to know the age of the building. I want to know the physical structure. I want to know its location. I want to know the tenants that are in it. So I'm going to be factoring in risk premiums. Macro or systematic risk, what's Trump doing on tax policy? What's Janet Yellen doing in regards to fiscal monetary policy? And there could be other factors that affect the discount rate. So we're going to do discount, present, future value terminologies. We'll be talking about future values, present values, compounding of those cash flows, and then discounting those cash flows. The standard typical finance model sets up basically a timeline. This is your cash outflows, usually at the beginning of the period. I'm going to buy the real estate, I'm going to buy the stock, I'm buying the company, I'm going to build this plant, and then we have future cash flows that we're going to receive in the future. And then usually in the last year, you're going to receive not only the cash flow, but you're going to receive a terminal value. Train you on how to calculate a terminal value so that you can discount these all back to the present to get the present value. Again, you get a present value minus the cost. You're going to get a net present value. And what you'll learn is that the net present value is positive, you're going to do it. You're going to buy it, you're going to build it. If it's negative, you're going to reject it. And then I'll get into the science behind that a little bit later. So setting up the timelines is really important. Future values is really just a compounding factor. So you all should have your financial calculators, and I would start pulling out the calculators and bringing the calculators to class. When you walk into a meeting, everybody walks in with their cup of coffee, their notepad, their cell phone, or maybe a tablet, maybe a laptop, and a calculator, because they're all ready to do the calculations and start running numbers. Okay. Either you can do them in your head, but usually we're going to want you to also do them on the calculator to make sure that I got multiple people within the room that are giving me the same answer, because that's going to validate and verify the numbers. If I only got one person doing it, I'm not going to accept it. Okay. I need to have multiple validations when I do the calculations, so we know that as we move forward, we're using the right numbers. Okay. So it's really important that you get used to bringing the calculator again. So in the future values, you're going to have some type of principal. You're going to invest $10,000 in whatever it is. Let's say at 10%. So it's 1 plus I, which is going to be the interest rate that you're going to get on it, or the return that you're going to get on it. And you're going to take it to the number of time period. Years. So I'm going to do 10% over 5 years, you're going to have to build this future value interest factor, which is your compound factor. It's also called the future value interest factor. So it's 1 plus I to the n times the principal amount. So in this case, it was $100. I'm going to get 10% over 1 year. So it's 100 times 1.1. So it's $110. I'm going to get 10%. For 2 years, annual return, it's 100 times 1.1 squared. It's going to give me 121. So on your homeworks and your exams, you should be calculating out the factors. So I can see that you're discounting them. And, you know, work through the proofs. Practice, deriving the proofs, because you're not going to have a computer someday, and you might have to do the discounting and the future value factor by hand. Okay. So you need to be able to do that. Compound interest. You have a holding period. In this case, it's 5 years. We have the value at the beginning of the period. We're going to get $10 per period. I'm also going to get interest on the interest. That's compounding. I'm going to have to accumulate interest. So this is the compound interest. And then the value of the investment at the end of the period, over the five-year holding period. A lot of this is going to be internal. Most people don't break down the table, but it's just kind of a decomposition of the interest on the interest. Not only are you getting interest on the principal, but you're getting interest on the interest. And that's why the compounding is really an exponential factor when you get to very high rates of return. FVM is the future value, PV is the principal amount or the present value, I is the interest rate per period, and N is the number of compounding periods. And this is your future value factor. What you'll find out, let's say I'm going to buy a bond that that pays semi-annually. So it's a bond, 1 year bond that pays semi-annually. So I'm going to you want to remember that you always divide the interest rate by the payment period. So if it's semi-annual, you want to divide the interest rate by 2. And then the compounding factor is n times n. So if it's quarterly, it's going to be 1 year times 4. If it's semi-annual, it's going to be 1 year times 2. And the interest rate is going to be paid semi-annually. So it's going to be interest rate divided by 2. So you need to remember how to make those adjustments to the compounding periods. And obviously, the more compounding periods there are, the more the money is going to be worth, because you're compounding it more often. And this graph just shows that you're getting paid the interest, but you're also getting interest on the interest. Okay. So if you get, say you invest $1 million or $100,000 or a dollar, whatever it is, you know, you're not going to get anywhere if you're getting zero interest. So again, it gets back to those negative interest rates. Imagine that those people are buying these bonds with negative interest rates. So it's actually creating that. And if you take into consideration inflation, their real rate of return is actually bad. So it's horrible. It's horrible. At 5%, you'll accumulate at this rate. 10%, you'll accumulate at this. 15 and 20. So what we'll learn at the end there is when you start to get in the 8 to 10% range, your money's going to double in less than 10 years. That's the key right there. This is it. I'm an investment manager, and I'm providing a product, or I'm making a recommendation of real estate asset. I got it hit an expected return, annual rate return, of at least 8 to 10%. Everybody's looking for 8 to 10%. Everybody. Some people want more, some people are willing to take less. But really everybody, if you look at the data and the research, everybody wants an 8 to 10% rate of return because they can double their money in 10 years. And if you can give them 8 to 10% with relatively low risk, you're in, you're done, you did it, everybody's happy. So the future value factor, again, like I was talking about before, interest rate divided by the compounding period, and then the compounding period multiplied by the holding period, the number of periods. So when you're doing semi-annual compounding, we're assuming 5% by 2 years, semi-compounding times 2 years. Here's your factor, 1.0254. This is your future value factor, which can also be your discount factor, and then you get the future value. Continuous compounding is the interest rate times the compounding period, or the number of the holding period. This is where you're going to get the highest future value, is when you go continuous. It means that it's compounding in a continuous fashion. And under continuous compounding, it becomes the theory of E. E is 2.71828. So you just take that, take that, take the future value factor, and I would start practicing doing the financial calculators too. So if you know the inputs, and I would make sure you clear your register, okay, so you don't carry anything over when you're doing the calculations, especially when you're taking the CPA exam or the CFA exam or your accounting exams or your finance exams. You want to make sure your registers are clean and make sure you have good batteries too, because you don't want your batteries going dead on you in the middle of your CPA or your CFA exam. That could be tragic. So these are the five factors. So the number of years in the holding period, the return on an annual basis. You got the present value or the amount that you put in and invested. Make sure you have the negative. You're not getting any payments. And you need to figure out what the future value factor is. So if you know four of the knowns, you don't know the unknown, you can just plug it. So you plug these in, and then you push the F and boom, the answer comes from. You gotta remember, am I receiving the cash flows at the beginning of the period or at the end of the period? So you gotta set the mode either to beginning. If it's beginning, it's annuity due, or you're receiving it at the end. In most cases, you're receiving the cash flows at the end of the period. Make sure you clear the calculator and have four decimal points. And then what I'll do later on is I'll pull up some of the Excel spreadsheets, and I will also provide you with the Excel spreadsheets from the book so that you can archive those and take those with you, because you might be asked to, if you have any, wherever you go to work, and it's nice to have a bunch of Excel templates to take with you. Do you have that in accounting? Do they provide you with Excel spreadsheets for investment purposes? No? Do they do that in your ops or any of your other classes? Where you're walking away with a toolbox, you know, of Excel spreadsheets to be able to calculate stuff?
Global operations is kind of how it's going to Excel.
Okay, but they don't provide you with any templates to solve it. I'll give you all the templates. Okay, so you have them. And then I'll walk you through some. On the present value side, could you move that? Thank you for moving it here, I appreciate it. Has anybody reviewed any of the videos? Are they helpful?
Yeah.
Am I talking loud enough?
It could be a little louder.
A little louder, I could speak up.
I don't know if there's anything that, yeah, I'm not gonna tell you to speak louder, but.
Okay, but can you hear it? Because I've had people say that some of them, they can't hear me.
You can hear them.
Okay.
You just have to.
Okay, perfect. Or maybe put it on your speaker.
Yeah.
And just crank it.
Yeah.
So the present value discounting, the discount rate is really important that you understand the discount. The discount rate could be your expected return. I want a 20% rate of return, boom, that determines the discount rate. Or maybe if I'm a company and I'm buying another company or I'm doing capital budgeting, looking to invest in some plant equipment, I'm not gonna use the expected return, I might, but usually what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use our cost of capital, okay? And I'll show you how to determine the cost of capital using the capital asset pricing. So there's models in this class that you need to memorize, okay? Like the Fisher equation, capital asset pricing model, weighted average cost of capital, there's all these things you need to memorize, okay? And if you can't remember them, then tattoo them on your body somewhere so that you can remember them for the rest of your life, okay? All right, so the present value is the discounted value of the future cash flows. Always remember, if the discount rate goes up, the present value goes down. The interest rate goes down, the present value goes up. If the interest rate goes up, the net present value goes down. The interest rate goes up, then the internal rate of return goes down. Okay, those are all the major factors. And if interest rates go down, present values go up, net present values go up, internal rates of return. I'll get into more details on that. So your future value interest factor is basically your present value interest factor, depending on how you look at it. So I can grow out the principal amount by 10% to get 110, and then I can take that 1.1, divide that into the 110, and I can get 100. Okay, so your future value and your present value are related to each other. It depends on what you're trying to do. Are you trying to grow out cash flows, or are you trying to discount cash flows today? And this future value, present value, is basically the bulwark of financial economics. Okay? You're going to be doing it in banking, you're going to be doing it in investment banking, you're going to be doing it in accounting, you're going to be doing it if you're doing capital budgeting on any type of IT projects. You're going to be using the standard financial theory that's been accepted as theory and is used by all corporations. When you're discounting, this is the value of the cash flow. And as you can see, as the discount factors get bigger, the value gets smaller and smaller. And again, you can grow the cash flows into the future, the future value. You can discount the cash flows back to get the present value. But I'll do examples of investments. I'll do a company, I'll do a stock, I'll do a bond, I'll do mergers and acquisitions, I'll do a piece of real estate, and I'll show you different ways of using this across different investment decisions. Okay. I probably won't get too much into the cash flow statements, but let me dig around, see if I can find some good pro forma income statements, which are projected cash flows, which is really the heart and soul. I mean, if you go work at a company in their acquisitions department or in their marketing department, in a private equity firm or a bank or any of these companies, again, you're going to be working with spreadsheets and you're going to be working with income statements in those cases, and you got to be proficient in not only the Excel but also to do the investment. Calculating the PV, again, if you know the holding period, if you know what the return is, in this case the payment is zero, you know the future value, you can plug and figure out the present value. If you know the present value and you don't know the future value, plug in the numbers, you can calculate the future value. If you know the holding period, you know the present value, you know payments and the future value, but you don't know the internal rate of return, calculator, you can push the I and it will calculate the return for you. Finding interest rate, or the yield or the growth rate, maybe you want to project growth in sales or rate of return or internal rate of return, effective interest rate. Again, if you know the holding period, in this case, the present current sales, the future sales, payment zero, you can calculate the growth rate in the sales. Again, five-year holding period, I know what the initial value of the house is. No payments, I know the future value of the house. I can calculate the appreciation rate on the house. I know the rate of return. I know the down payment that I can put up. No payment. I know the down payment that's required. I can calculate what, how many periods I need to invest at 5% to be able to accumulate enough to get to the down payment that I need to buy the house or the, so this is also called a sinking fund in finance. I want to figure out, I only have so much money, put it into a fund, I can get 5%, I need to know how long it's going to take until I can get to the future value to basically take out some bonds, buy back some stock, buy a piece of equipment, buy a roof, put in some infrastructure spending, whatever it is. It tells me how many years it's going to take at that interest rate based on that initial investment and how much I need in the future. I can figure out how long it's going to take me. And then the rule of 72. You want to break out your calculator and calculate this. So the rule of 72 basically states how long is it going to take me to double my money? Okay. So 72 divided by the return is going to give me the number of years it takes for me to double my money. So you might as well calculate these, give them to me, and memorize them. Okay. So if I'm getting a 3% rate of return on my money, how many years does it take me to double my money?
24.
24? So do I want to be investing at 3%? If I offered you an investment that got 3%, would you take it from me? It's a long time. And what if inflation is 3%? Your real rate is zero. So you're going down. Okay. What about 5%? 72 divided by 5. 14 and a half years. If I'm 55 years old, is that going to be good for me? No, because I'm retiring in 10. Okay. What about 8? 72 divided by 8. 9 years. So less than 10. Okay, now we're talking. What about 72 divided by 10? 10%. 72. Okay, now we're talking. What about 15%? What is it?
4.8.
Okay. So less than 5 years. And what about 20%?
3.6.
And what about 25%?
2.88.
What is it?
2.88.
So the markets are segmented, all right? Capital markets are segmented. This is probably, you know, safe realm here. Institutional investors, endowments, they're really not looking for return, they're looking for loan risk. Okay. And so this would probably be institutional, but even they don't want this. Okay. Because this is pretty much unacceptable. They're looking for this. Okay. Almost all, you know, risk-averse investors, institutional investors, retail investors like yourself, if you can get basically an 8 to 10% rate of return on your money consistently over time, 10, 20, 30 years, 30 years, it's going to double, it's going to double, it's going to double. So that's what you're looking for. The tortoise and the hare. The hares are down here. you're looking for, I want a big rate of return because I want to double my money in less than 3 years. So these are your VC guys. These are your opportunistic and value-add investors on the real estate side. They want their money to double in less than 3 years. There's not a lot of investments out here that can provide that. And these are very risky investments in most cases. And I've seen a lot of clients get seduced into this to lose all their money. I can get you a 25% rate of return. Give me your money, I'll get you 25%. Lost all their money, stole all their money. Okay. So when you're hearing this, have a discussion. The 15 to 20% venture capitalists, speculators in real estate, they're looking for this because they're investing in projects that are highly risky. So they're really targeting here. Most people are targeting here, risk-averse investors here. Very risk-averse investors. People that are looking for really no risk out here. The bulk of the people are here. Almost all investors are in this range. Some will go into this range, but again, the probability of losing is higher than here. And then the probability of losing is really high. So you need to be focused. Okay? So the rule of 72, I would memorize things so that you have them. Pretty much done unless anybody has any questions.
Is there a specific kind of calculator that you want us to use?
You know what? The two calculators, you know, the HP, I guess, is that the financial analyst?
I think so.
And then there's the TI, which is like $30 or something, the TI analyst 2 or something like that. It's really basic. It's a good calculator. You know, that's the one I would probably pick. And I believe that the TI is the financial calculator that's used in the book.
Okay.
So the steps correspond with that calculator. Okay. Any questions? That's all I got. We accomplished a lot. And I'll be around if you need me to take a look at your memos or if you want to check your solutions.